When you think about urban design today, where are we in the continuum? Is this an ebb and flow? Are we coming back and forth into an idea, an ethic, a philosophy that we've had?
Yeah, I think we're returning to some timeless qualities. You know, we took a little detour after World War II. We were wealthier than any other middle class in the history of mankind, and we had a new technology that everybody was in love with, and we subsidized it with highway investments and with GI bills, and we got sprawl. You know, the 2008 crash was all about people not being able to afford to drive that far to have that size yard. But simultaneously, you know, the demographics have shifted. It's not that everybody's going to move back to the city. That's a little bit of a misnomer that people get very excited about. So we've got to rethink the way we build our cities. It can't be this one-size-fits-all paradigm that we've had for so long.
So what are the best kind of cities or towns that you've seen around the country and how they're coping with different kind of climate-related problems, or as they think about and redesign this, what kind of yields have they gotten back?
Well, the signature, of course, is Portland, and everybody discounts Portland. I don't know why. You know, Portland was a complete dump in the 60s and 70s. I mean, nobody wanted to be in Portland. The downtown was horrible. But they basically, through great design and by shifting from cars and highways to transit, there was a seminal moment in 1990 where they decided to build the West Side Light Rail Line and put, you know, like a string of pearls along it, a series of neighborhoods that were walkable, instead of a new Beltway freeway. Same dollars, just shifted to a whole nother system, not only of transportation, but of living. Complete success story. So by 96, the average vehicle miles traveled per household in Portland has dropped, whereas the average across America has continued to rise. So we become more and more auto-dependent with all the negative attributes that that brings. But Portland is kind of a case study and a proof. It's a laboratory that says, yeah, this really works.
The urban heat islands that we see in big cities, how significant is it when we have density without planning, in the sense that without having perhaps green roofs or enough open space, et cetera, et cetera?
You know, it's ironic because one of the first places I worked in my life was Sacramento, and the reverse was true. Downtown Sacramento, which had these beautiful canopies over the streets, was on average 10 degrees cooler in the summer than the suburbs, which didn't have mature trees and were more spread out. And so actually, it's not always the case that you get this heat island effect. And that goes to the key issue here. The moment you create great walkable streets, and believe me, street trees are always a central piece of that. You can't have a great street without great street trees. You solve a lot of that problem right then and there. Street trees, it's that simple. And yeah, you can do white roofs and green roofs, and you know, there are other mitigating factors, but believe me, it's that street canopy that makes all the difference.